Welcome into the Skinny Podcast, the weekly Potpourri edition. I'm Richard Skinner, local12.com digital sports columnist and editor with Rick Broering. As always, it's presented by Blake, the attorney Maislin. And we got a lot to talk about on this week's edition. Although it's kind of fluid, we still will have probably some Bengals free agency news trickle out after this podcast. We've obviously got both UC, Xavier, actually, and Kentucky still involved in their conference tournaments as we're recording this. So we got a little fluid portion of the podcast, Rick, but we still got a lot to get over.
Yeah, and I mean, typically with these podcasts recently, we've been starting with college basketball. It's that time of the year. We both love college basketball. But Skinny, it's been a sports talk show host stream this week in Cincinnati. There's been all types of things happening around the sports world. So we're actually going to kick it off with the Bengals because NFL free agency has kind of dominated the last few days. And I guess we can go good news, bad news. We'll start with the bad in this case, or not even necessarily bad, but just the unpleasant news for Bengals fans. And that is, wide receiver T. Higgins has asked for a trade. Higgins was franchise tagged on February 26, just a few weeks ago. And then Adam Schefter said in a tweet this week that Higgins loves Cincinnati and hoped to be with the team long term, but he's disappointed that the team has not had any talks about a long term contract extension since March of 2023. He's ready to move on to a new home. So, Skinny, what is the likelihood that the Bengals will trade T. Higgins?
Less than 1%, in my opinion, because there's just no value in return that you're going to get to make this deal movable. They've made it clear they want him here this year. The franchise tag allows them to do that. Listen, he can demand a trade, and his agent can demand a trade all they want. You know how much leverage they have in this situation? Zilch. I mean, literally, zilch. You can maybe not sign it and play, but that doesn't benefit you. You're leaving $21.8 million guaranteed on the table. That means guaranteed if he gets hurt in the very first practice of training camp that he's involved in, whatever that day may be, sometime probably in August, he's getting $21.8 million guaranteed. Also, you need to show that last year was a little bit of an outlier. Injuries got him nicked up. He had some drop issues. He had a couple of real special moments, the Vikings game and the long touchdown run and catch against the Steelers, or catch and run rather, against the Steelers. But all told, that was kind of a down year for T. Higgins last season. So he needs to put a great season together in order to go get paid after this season. So, again, I get it. I get the frustration. It's the machinations of all this. And then, you know, national people pick up on it and wonder, what's it going to do to the locker room? It's going to do zero to the locker room. Just like the Jonah Williams situation. Listen, Jonah wanted a trade. At the end of the day, nowhere to go. They weren't going to deal him. He was fine. He was a pro. T. Higgins will come. He won't be here for OTAs, and that's fine. Everybody understands that. Teammates understand that. He probably won't be here for the start of training camp. He'll sign sometime in August like Jesse Bates did. And then just like Jesse Bates and just like Jonah Williams, T. Higgins will play. He'll play up to the best of his ability. Hopefully it's 17 games worth of the best you get out of T. Higgins, because it will be a great season if that's the case for probably him and the team. But, you know, this whole trade thing it's just silly.
The players don't like the franchise tag, and I might even agree that it is silly. But we've already seen a player try to go against it and battle it, and his name is Le'Veon Bell.
Yep.
And he's completely threw his career off track by
doing
so.
Correct.
They just, like you said, there is no leverage. There is no way out once you get franchise tagged, essentially. There's not much to worry about here, I don't think. I guess the only conversation to have is what you just brought up, which is, does it affect things inside the locker room? And to that point, at some point, if we're going to keep saying Joe Burrow is this master whisperer and leader of how to keep all these guys together, and he makes everyone want to play with him, and he's so cool, then doesn't that solve most of the issues here? Don't we not have to worry about that because he's got the reins and he's going to be the leader in the locker room, and all the guys want to play with him anyway, regardless of whether T. Higgins is completely happy this year or not? I'm not too worried about the Bengals locker room.
Yeah, that's the least of my worries in all of this. And, I go back to, it's fine. You can demand the trade. You can ask for a trade. You can ask for those things. I think the public portion of this is the frustration from the Higgins camp of the Bengals and his side have not talked since March of last year.
Yeah,
but here's my thing. Well, here's what I make of it. The Bengals have a number. David Mulugeta has a number. Neither are going to budge off of that number, especially Mulugeta. And if he's saying, I'm not budging, this is the number, got Bengals. This is the number you have to get to. And if that's the case and he doesn't want to budge, that's fine. Hey, listen, go look at a lot of these free agent signings across the league. There are a lot of David Mulugeta clients that are getting paid. So kudos to him. He's doing his job. The Bengals are also doing their job. And this is just simply the business of the NFL. If he's not going to move off of his number, what is there to talk about if you're the Bengals? I think that's where we're at with this from a long-term standpoint.
Well, isn't that also how negotiating works? Like, the first side to cave usually is the side that has less leverage, usually right. is the side that doesn't have as much strength, right? I mean, so if the Bengals already said this is our number and they don't want to cave on that, then there's not really a lot to talk about in terms of negotiating right now.
That's why there's been nothing to talk about. That's why they haven't talked.
I think people saw this as a slight at T. Higgins and like some personal relationship that was being broken up with the Bengals and T. Higgins. And it's like, no, this is business. This is how business works. This is negotiating. These are agents and front office people playing this out. This isn't Zach Taylor and T. Higgins Correct. Fighting, and now they're not talking for a year because of his contract Correct. Negotiations. And I think fans don't always realize what we're talking about here. I don't think this is some rare thing, the fact that agents and front office people haven't negotiated in over a year on a contract that they're just too far apart on.
Yeah, and for those that believe that the franchise tag is not fair, I'm going to give you two things of why it is. Number one, it's because the players collectively bargained it. I mean, it wasn't like the NFL said, this is it. No, it was collectively bargained between both sides. The other part is, when you get franchise tag, it's the value of the five highest paid receivers at the position at the time they do this. They put the formula. 21.8 mil is life-changing money. I don't care who you think. And again, he's got a chance to make four times that maybe on the open market next year. But play for your 21.8 mil, play well, don't get hurt, and you're going to wind up getting a payday just like Jesse Bates did. David Mulugeta, again, he gambled on Jesse Bates too. It was, here's our number. Bengals were, here's our number. And the Bengals made an offer. But it wasn't what they wanted. Okay, so we are at our stalemate. I do think the risk is your player suffers something catastrophic or something that just really derails their career from an injury standpoint. So you're kind of holding your breath for that. But listen, Jesse Bates balled out in 2022, went and got paid, had a great year this past year for the Atlanta Falcons. I think it was a win for both sides. The Bengals got an extra year out of Jesse Bates, and then Jesse Bates got paid. In this case, you get an extra year out of T. Higgins. He plays great. He gets paid.
I'm glad we're not in person doing this. You can't throw anything at me, and I hope you won't roll your eyes too hard when I ask you this next question, but it's been on social media the last few days. I have to bring it up here, Skinny. Is there anything at all to the Justin Jefferson rumors?
No.
Point blank, move on.
No, yes.
Okay. I
mean, who, was it Tyler Eifert, the one that brought that up?
No, it was somebody's wife or sister that worked with Joe Burrow's girlfriend at the Kenwood Town Center and the Baskin Robbins and the sister's mother's uncle's girlfriend. I don't know. It's typical silly free agent rumor time is what it is.
That's correct. We're in that part of the season.
Okay. So there were a lot of other bits and pieces of news that came in. I think we'll start with the new additions. Obviously there were some extensions, some guys that they're bringing back that were already with the team. But the big news, I think, is some of the new names that are coming from the outside that were free agent signees. And we'll start with the biggest of those. That was defensive tackle Sheldon Rankins. He signed a 2-year, $26 million deal, or he will sign that. He's agreed to that. Skinny, what was your thoughts when you first saw this come across?
So I did a six-part series leading into free agency the week before where I did the position groups that they were probably going to attack, and tackle was one of them. And I wrote that I thought Sheldon Rankins was out of their price range, and so I really didn't even consider him. But the way they judiciously spent leading up to the Sheldon Rankins agreement that he hasn't officially signed yet, but he's going to. You got Geno Stone, and I think at the value I thought he was worth. In fact, that's who I thought was the perfect target, about $7.5 million a year, and it worked out. I thought he'd get 3 years. He got two, but that's the thing. Zach Moss came in a little cheaper than I thought that he would. Mike Gesicki comes in at a fairly reasonable cost. The fact that they attack these spots with serviceable players at nice cost allowed them then to splurge on that position. And again, I'm a little surprised that they were able to do it, but because they were so judicious at the other spots, they were able to go get Sheldon Rankins, and they need inside pass rush push. And he provides that. I think that was a great get. Did they overpay for him? Probably, because they did get into a bidding war, apparently. But at the end of the day, when you were so good at the way you spent at these other spots, and they still are going to spend at right tackle, it's allowed them to bring Von Bell back, actually, at a one-year, $6 million rate to provide even more depth at safety and more veteran leadership. Again, kudos to them. They may have not done drafts right, and I pointed that out to how they're paying the sins for 21 and 22. But I'll be honest, Rick, the last few years in free agency, there's been a guy here. I mean, Trey Waynes, you didn't know he was going to get hurt. I mean, for goodness sakes.
Right.
They've been really good in free agency.
Well, and even some of the guys that maybe haven't worked out perfectly, you can't fault the process or right. what they were going for with the moves that they've made in free agency the last few years. They've been aggressive. They've sometimes overpaid a little bit when they've needed to because they had a guy that fit what they needed at that time. And I think Sheldon Rankins falls into that camp. He may be a little overpriced at what they're paying him, 2 years, $26 million. But we talked about it going into the offseason. Defensive line help was probably the most glaring need going into the free agency season. And they have addressed that in a big way. And so I think the Sheldon Rankins signing definitely kind of made everyone's head turn a little bit when that popped up on Wednesday night. But Skinny, you mentioned three other guys too. Safety Geno Stone that they are adding, 2 years, $15 million. Tight end Mike Gesicki, who is 1 year, $3.25 million deal. And Zach Moss, the running back, 2 years, $8 million. Are all three of those guys going to make an impact? Because it kind of feels like everyone they've added here are impact type players for this team next year.
Yeah, let's start with Geno Stone. Again, that was when I wrote my safety piece. Again, I listed like the top 15 guys, but then when you write and go through it, it's like these five or six are off the charts from a financial standpoint. And Geno Stone was the perfect landing spot. And then to go get Von Bell on top of that. So now you've got.
Yeah, so is that a done deal too? The Von Bell thing that broke late last night,
but it seems like a rumor.
Actually,
national guys have reported the Bengals have not made it official yet. They've not made any of these really official yet, but we expect that today. Actually, I'm going down there to the stadium because we're going to have media availability with somebody. We still don't know who at this point, but maybe some buddies. But yes, Von Bell is back. 1 year, $6 million guaranteed. So now that gives you Geno Stone, Von Bell, Jordan Battle as a nice three-headed monster back there. It also allows you to do what we all believe they were going to do, and that's move Dax Hill up to the corner spot, and he can play safety. He's your fifth safety on the roster. Tyson Anderson's probably your fourth, and hell, Dax might even be your fourth. It gives you nice flexibility. I think they're going to really rep him. As Lou Anarumo told us at the Combine, they want him to learn one thing, and I think that means they don't want him jockeying back and forth between everything. So I think he's going to learn slot corner, to be quite frank, to then be the replacement for Mike Hilton or maybe even slide into more snaps than Mike Hilton as this year goes on. So yeah, I thought that was a brilliant signing. I know the cynical approach to Geno Stone would be, well, he only started really a handful of games in this past season for Baltimore, didn't play a big role prior to that. It kind of has a Nick Scott vibe, but he had a really good year last year. Nick Scott was okay with the Rams the year he started. His pass grade from PFF among safeties ranked seventh overall. He ranked second among all NFL players in interceptions. He ranked first among safeties in interceptions. And I think it's an ascending player. And it's, again, to their credit, it wasn't just go get Geno Stone and don't have a fallback plan. You do have a fallback plan. It's Von Bell. It's maybe Dax Hill if worse comes to worse. Again, so I think that's the smart play there for that spot. Let's go to running back. I know there's a lot of people wringing their hands about Joe Mixon being traded. A lot of us have written about, don't look at the 1,000-yard season. I mean, a lot of the advanced metrics on Joe Mixon this past year were not good. And, you know, the old axiom in sports is, and I think it holds true, it's better to get out from under a guy a year too early rather than a year too late. They wanted to get more explosiveness at the position, and Zach Moss is a more explosive player. And they did not get Zach Moss to come in here to be the 25-carry-a-game bell cow. I think this is truly a rotational piece between he and Chase Brown where, you know, you get those guys on a rotational basis, and maybe you still are looking for your third down blocking back, and maybe that's still the role that Drew Sample will play if that's the case. But for the most part, that was a rotational piece. And then Mike Gesicki, who's not a great inline blocker, but you know, he had really good years in Miami. Didn't have a great year this past year, but I point out to the fact of two things there. He split some time with Hunter Henry, and Mac Jones was his freaking quarterback, man.
Yep.
You know, and in that offense, they didn't exactly have dynamic wide receivers to take some of the pressure off as well. So Mike Gesicki is a really good athlete as a tight end. You get Higgins and him and maybe whatever Charlie Jones is a slot guy. You got four dudes that can stretch the field at that point. That's going to be tough.
Well, here's what I'm most interested in, Skinny. We were talking about Tanner Hudson and the tight end spot and Drew Sample. And I was saying, you know, I like the idea of Tanner Hudson. I think going that route seems like it might be best for the offense in terms of what they're doing. And we kind of talked about, yeah, but you need blocking and he doesn't really do that. And it feels like going the Gesicki route is adding another guy that's kind of in the Tanner Hudson mold. He's more of a receiver, more not athletic. As much of a blocker. Yeah, well, right. I'm not saying he's not better than Tanner Hudson, but my point is he seems to be more in that mold and not as much of a blocker. So it's kind of interesting to me that they saw a little bit of Tanner Hudson at the end of the year. We know what his shortcomings were, which was the inline blocking and that type of thing. And they went out and said, you know what? Let's get maybe a better version of that guy, a bit more of a receiver type, more of a slot type of guy almost, as opposed to the inline blocking tight end. It makes me a little curious about, okay, what did they see at the end of the year with Tanner Hudson? How much do they like that? And what do they have planned for this year on the offensive side once Joe Burrow is back?
Well, and that was Dan Pitcher at the Combine telling us his main goal was to find ways to get more explosive plays. And one of the ways to find ways to get more explosive plays is get more explosive players, right? Zach Moss is a more explosive player at this point of his career than Joe Mixon. Mike Gesicki is a more explosive player than any tight end you can put on the field for the Bengals at the moment. And honestly, just from a pure receiving standpoint, probably one of the more explosive receiving tight ends in the NFL. And again, that was the theme of this offseason. It was pointed out to us clearly at the Combine. I wrote a lot of us wrote stories on it. And they're putting their money literally where their mouth is about one way to get more explosive. Isn't it just designing explosive plays? It's getting more explosive players.
Makes a lot of sense to me. Skinny, also, there were a handful of guys that were already on the team that they have re-signed or they will re-sign on extensions. Akeem Davis-Gaither, the linebacker, 1 year, $3 million. Drew Sample got a 3-year extension. Travion Williams is going to sign a 1-year extension. Cody Ford, 1-year extension. What is the most important extension out of those, or if there's any others that I missed?
I think Akeem Davis-Gaither, it's surprised. I thought he'd try to test the market for more defensive playing time. He just hasn't gotten a lot the last few years on defense because Logan Wilson and Jermaine Pratt have been durable players. Kudos to them and whatnot. But I thought Akeem would test the market, kick the tires, and see if somebody wanted to sign him for, you know, to be more of a defensive player. But I think he fills two great roles. I think he's a quality backup, and he's a core special teams guy. I mean, really at the top notch of their core special teams guys. And so to me, that's an important signing. And the Drew Sample signing, whether we like him as a player or not, and I'll give him credit. I thought this past year they found a niche for him. He found a niche for himself. But boy, I remember Brian Callahan. I can't even remember how he got on the topic one day. We got on the topic of something, and Drew Sample's name got mentioned. I kid you not, Rick. He pontificated on that dude for 2 minutes. It's the longest typed out quote I've ever seen in my lifetime. It literally, it probably filled this much screen if you just type the quote out. And I think, and Zach Taylor's mentioned this a lot of times, they see great value in Drew Sample. Maybe we don't, and maybe we haven't, but they do. And that's where the thing that made me, I think we talked about is I thought they would re-sign Drew Sample. I still think they bring Tanner Hudson back if it's possible. I do. So I thought they were bringing Drew Sample back. The thing that surprised me was the 3 years. That's the thing that surprised me a little bit.
Yeah, same here. I mean, they're clearly committed to the guy. They like what he brings. They feel like he is just solid. They know what they're going to get out of him. I would imagine they realize there's not a ton of upside there. He's not going to become an explosive playmaker within the offense, but he does what you're asking him to do, and you can rely on him. I wish they'd make it easy for everyone, Skinny. I think everyone would like Drew Sample. We'd all be on the same page with Drew Sample if we just called him what he really is. Bring back the fullback.
Yeah, right. No,
he's
right.
A that's fullback, right. Skinny. That's right. What he is. Let's just call him that.
Yeah, that's right. That's a good
call. That I think everyone would like him. Skinny, there were some losses too. Chidobe Awuzie signed a 3-year deal with the Titans. Obviously, Joe Mixon was traded to the Texans for a 7th-round pick. Nick Scott was released. DJ Reader is visiting with the Lions this week. And obviously, after the Rankin signing, I think people are wondering what DJ Reader's future looks like. What do you think about there?
I still think it's a possibility unless the Lions give him just an offer that he can't refuse. I mean, Sheldon Rankins is a 3 technique that's probably going to be a rotational piece with B.J. Hill. You still need nose tackles on this roster, and that's what D.J. Reader is. I mean, he's a pure nose tackle. You know, maybe the Bengals gave him a price, and he didn't like it, and they said, hey, listen, man, go test the market, and if you don't find anything, offer's still good. And I wonder if that's what it comes down to. Again, he could sign with the Lions 10 minutes after this podcast is over. He goes up there, he visits, and they say, here's the offer, and it's a great offer, and he takes it. And I hope whatever it is the case for him, because he was probably going to get a nice payday if he hadn't gotten hurt. And maybe somebody is like the Lions are still willing to give him that nice payday. So I don't think it's out of the realm yet. And it wouldn't shock me if he resigns here.
Yeah, it always seemed like that was going to be the play for the Bengals here. Is with DJ, it's like, okay, this didn't play out the way any of us wanted to with your injury happening, but let's see what's out there for you. And then if it makes sense for us to bring you back on the cheap, you don't have anywhere left, we'd love to have you back. So I think this is kind of expected the way that it is playing out. Skinny, where does the focus turn to now for the Bengals? They've made a lot of moves already, but what's the big move out there they still need to make?
Right tackle. And I do think Mekhi Becton's visiting. I know he doesn't make people go wow, and I get it. He's been plagued by injuries. He's a former first round draft pick, didn't have a great year this past year for the Jets, although he played a little bit better at right tackle when he was playing there. And I've said all along, in fact, that's the guy when I wrote the right tackle piece, I settled on Mekhi Becton on a 1-year prove it deal that's beneficial to both. That gives you the fallback plan for, I think if it is Mekhi Becton, and it's going to be somebody of that ilk, it's going to be a 1-year stopgap, in my opinion. If that's the case, I think the writing is clearly on the wall that they take a tackle at 18 overall. And you hope that J.C. Latham is the guy that slides there from Alabama. And I see more mock drafts that have him sliding there. So it gives you then the fallback plan that again, I'm not relying on a plug-and-play rookie. I'm hoping for the plug-and-play rookie. If not, we got the veteran over here. And while, again, he's had some issues, especially in pass blocking, I listen, Joe Burrow in the shotgun, seeing the rusher come at him, if that's the case in a worst-case scenario, is going to figure out a way to make that work. I mean, they made it work in a Super Bowl with Hakeem Adeniji, for goodness sakes. I mean, would you like an upgrade at right tackle? Sure. And again, it could be the rookie. I mean, if we'll just use J.C. Latham as an example. If he comes into camp and wows and outplays Mekhi Becton, and you start him there not because Mekhi Becton was awful, but because this kid has showed, hey, this guy is a plug-and-play guy. Great. But if not, if it's growing pains, which happens, you've got a veteran there to slide into that spot. And I think, again, it makes sense.
Okay, so we'll keep our eyes out for what they do at that right tackle position. Any other thoughts here on Bengals free agency as we wrap this up, Skinny?
Yeah, I do think they'll get a veteran corner at some point for depth to let the market settle. And I don't think receiver is out of the realm, veteran slot receiver on the cheap, just again to provide you a fallback plan if Charlie Jones doesn't work out. I think those are still good. And I think, again, because they've been so judicious in their spending other than Sheldon Rankins, I think they'll have a little bit of money left over to do those things.
All right, let's move on to the Reds, Skinny. Big news with the Reds came out last week after we recorded our podcast when it was announced that Noelvi Marte was busted for steroids. He's been suspended 80 games by the commissioner's office after testing positive for boldenone, I believe is how you say it, an anabolic steroid which was developed as a veterinary medication for horses and isn't approved for use in humans at all, Skinny. He also won't be eligible for the postseason roster if the Reds were to make the playoffs. Marte, of course, is the Reds' number one prospect and the number 23 prospect in Baseball America's top 100 prospects list. Skinny, what do you make of this whole Noelvi Marte situation? The fans are just totally dismayed by it.
Yeah, it's disappointing. I do wonder. Remember, he started spring training hurt with the hamstring injury suffered in whatever that classic was he played in, Dominican World, whatever the heck. And I wonder, I'm just wondering, spitballing here, if that was him trying to speed up the healing process. And maybe it was. And unfortunately, he got caught and learned a tough lesson, and so did the Reds. But this goes back to the whole, they got too many infielders. What are they going to do? Well, I mean, again, stuff happens, man. It's better to have more and not hope to go grab people than it is to go, oh, crap, now we need a third baseman.
The old classic, these things work themselves out. Came through in the most ridiculous way possible. Now, I have to imagine my first thought when I heard this, and maybe it was yours, was, did they know? Come on. They made all these decisions. They added Candelario. Did they know?
It's interesting. I don't think the Candelario one was, but when they brought Josh Harrison and Tony Kemp, two veterans, into camp, that made me go, okay, now when is this overkill? When is too much too much?
Yeah, so I do have a contact who knows Nick Kroll and his family well. And he said, talking to him within the last week, had a conversation with him, and he said, absolutely not. We had no involvement in this process. It was all handled by the league. We found out literally right before the news came out. We didn't get to negotiate or anything like that. So I don't know if you believe that or not. That's what Nick Kroll told a family friend. But my first thought when I heard this news was they had to have known. It makes this offseason make so much more sense if you do it under the pretense of, hey, one of your top prospects isn't going to be available for half the year or more. And look, maybe they didn't know. Clearly, it sounds like they didn't. But either way, like you said, it worked out perfectly for them to have these extra infielders, because otherwise we'd be sitting here looking at this news like it might have just derailed what was supposed to be a promising season.
Yeah, it looks like, I mean, it's a small sample size. It looks like Jonathan India's hitting his way into the lineup somehow, some way, right?
Well, it always felt like that was a real possibility because of his bat. And then once this happened, Skinny, then it opened the door wide, wide open for Jonathan India to get back into the lineup.
And I do, I'm just in that big Ben Zobrist move of, I love versatile guys. I think you can do so much mixing and matching from your lineup perspective. The fact that he's now been willing to go out in the outfield and looks like he kind of knows what he's doing a little bit out there. I think that's a great, I mean, you got so many guys that can play so many spots. You know, McClain can play second and short. Ellie can play short and third. Candelaria can play third and first. Encarnacio Strand can play third in a pinch, although he's probably more rooted at first. India can play first, second. Now the outfield. Spencer Steer can play the outfield third. And so, I mean, it's a great situation to be in. And Marte, yeah, whenever he comes back, you know, 80 games into this thing, I mean, he can play shortstop too. I mean, so you've got, and third base, obviously, which was going to be his position. I love the position versatility.
Now here's the question. Let's say the Reds are playing pretty well or midway through the year. He's available to come back. How do you start using him, Skinny? And then let's say, like, do you get concerned when you get closer to the very end of the year and you are going to make the playoffs, it looks like? Then what do you do? Do you leave him in the lineup, just keep playing him as normal? Or do you start to, like, pull him back because you're not going to have available for the playoffs and you want to have other guys going at that time? That seems like a tricky situation to handle potentially if you're the manager.
Right. Here's my answer to it. It'll work itself out, Rick.
That's true. It always does. It always does. All right. One of the other bits of news this week, Skinny, was Frankie Montas was named the opening day starter. Caught everyone by surprise a little bit. He'll open the season against the Nationals on March 28th at Great American Ballpark. Hunter Green will make the second start of the season. The Reds, of course, signed Montas as a free agent to a one-year, $16 million deal. Your thoughts on Montas being named? Is this to light a fire under Hunter Green? Dangle the carrot a little bit?
Yeah, I wondered that myself, too. Opening day starter is a very ceremonial thing, right? It's the usual purported ace of the staff getting that opening day start. And all the pomp and circumstance that goes with it, and maybe the ego that goes with it as well a little bit. And maybe that is the case. I also just wondered if, listen, the guy's the most veteran guy in your rotation. We're going to give him the start because he's the most veteran guy in the rotation.
But to your point, it doesn't really matter, right? I mean, it's not a big deal from a baseball standpoint. It really is just a stroke someone's ego.
Yes.
So if you've got a one-year guy who's a veteran who kind of gets that it doesn't matter, are you really putting him ahead of Hunter Green, who's supposedly their cornerstone franchise that you signed to a long-term deal, unless you're trying to send some type of message to Hunter Green?
But I don't know what that would be, to be honest with you, because
I don't either.
I mean, Hunter Green has an air of confidence around him. I mean, even when he's gotten rocked, there's still an air of confidence with him. He's seems too much to learn. He's obviously got great stuff. You know, when he got things right last year, he was really, really good. So I'm not sure, other than, again, just going, all right, let's just pick the most veteran guy on the staff. We're good.
Yeah, I mean, I'm with you on that, but I also just can't get past the idea that there doesn't seem to be much advantage to doing this other than
I want
Hunter Green to be thinking about this in some way, shape, or form. So I don't know
what
the message is that you're sending, but it seems like you want to knock Hunter Green down a peg a little bit and say, hey, you are not the ace of this staff right now, and you need to get there.
Maybe it's a prove-it situation. Maybe that's what it is of hey, listen, if you can string together this season and show that you're the ace of the staff, we'll make you the opening day starter the next 8 opening days, for goodness sake. So it was weird. I mean, I'll be honest with you. I had to write it for our website after it was announced, and I'm like, wait, what? It took me by surprise a little bit.
Yeah, a couple pieces of good news on the Red side of things. Matt McClain will be good for opening day. He just announced. And also last week, we were talking about Nick Lodolo and the concerns there when he mentioned he was still feeling that leg injury after a live BP session. And he actually made his spring training debut over the last week and did great. He threw two scoreless innings and didn't allow a hit, struck out one. So
I still
good times there.
Yeah, I'm glad he did it. And it was good news that he went out, because it's one thing to throw your bullpens. It's another thing to throw when there's live batters there and there's more stress on you, even though it's a spring training game. I think I heard David Bell, they were targeting April 9th to maybe getting back to the rotation. He's got to ramp up and whatnot. I still hold my breath until that date as they ramp him up and he does more and more and more. And hopefully he does. He clears it without any issues whatsoever. But until he does, I'm still a bit skeptical.
I am too. I mean, we talked about it last week. I have major concerns about Nick Lodolo now, but this was some positive news considering where it looked like it was heading a week or two ago. So any other Reds thoughts here, Skinny, before we get into college basketball?
No, they're down to 39 players, I think. So about 13 more roster moves need to be made before they get their final roster set. And as I said before, the one thing with this team and any team anymore, the 26 to start on opening day, there's going to be 24 more probably at some point to come up. And I do like the depth of this organization at the moment.
All right. College basketball time. Next week will be our March Madness preview breakdown show. So we'll start off with the college basketball, get all into that next week. This week's kind of weird because we've got all the teams still playing. UC and Xavier both play today in their conference tournaments later. Kentucky will start on Friday, which is tomorrow. NKU season did already come to an end earlier this week on Monday night. The Norris had beat Wright State last Thursday in an overtime thriller, 99-97, one of the craziest finishes you'll ever see. Crazy. And then they lost to Milwaukee 82-75 in the semifinals. They at one point led that game by 15 in the first half, ended up losing.
And then gas tank went.
Yeah, it went to empty. And you know, they did have a break in between that Thursday night game and the Monday night game. It wasn't a long one, and they're pretty banged up right now, especially with their starting center, Keena Tijere, dealing with a sprained ankle. But it did just feel like that. And maybe you could argue, well, they've been playing few guys all year. Lots of teams are playing their starters a ton of minutes, and I think that's the case. But I think specifically against this matchup with Milwaukee, who has a 6'6 athletic combo guard and BJ Freeman coming downhill all game, and they play at the fastest pace in the conference, up-tempo the whole game, running down your throat. I think the first half when NKU was able to force turnovers, keep them out of the lane, do a great job defensively, it worked out wonderfully for them. They looked good. Second half, once they lost a little bit of that edge defensively and they couldn't get the turnovers, they couldn't keep the dribble penetration out of the lane, it just became a parade to the rim. They could not stop anything defensively in the second half.
Yeah, that's where Tijere's length and athleticism would have helped.
It would have. And he tried. I mean, he played some minutes in that game, but he just wasn't himself. Yeah. He wasn't really moving. Skinny, Trey Robinson, just an unreal performance. He picked a great night to have his best game of his career, scored 33 in the semifinals loss against Milwaukee. I mean, you look at that performance, what he did. He's coming off the Defensive Player of the Year award that he just won for the regular season. He puts up 33 like that. He does have another year of eligibility. And I think if you're an NKU fan, you saw that performance, you're thinking, man, I hope some way, somehow he ends up back at NKU next year.
We've seen guys like that, though, that parlay those into moving to a bigger program. The one thing I was saying, this is going to sound negative off of a guy who did what he did. I don't know where he would fit in a bigger program, if you know what I mean. I think he's in the right league for success for him.
Well, at the Horizon League, he is a versatile guy on defense who can guard anyone, and he can be a matchup problem on offense because he's kind of that. He is a bigger player, forward 6'7", but he's got perimeter skill, and he can be a matchup problem. At the high major level, I think he's more of a tweener. He's a guy that doesn't necessarily have a position. Yes. He's not really a power forward because he's a little small, and he's not really a wing because he's not a ball handler in that way and as skilled as you'd like those guys to be. So I kind of get where you're coming from on that. But I also think, you know, Sam Vinson is going to be back presumably after his ACL injury. He has 2 years of eligibility left if he gets a red shirt. Trey Robinson has that extra year. If you bring both of those guys back, you saw what Randall Pettis did towards the end of this year as he got more of a chance with Sam going down. Jeremiah Israel really had a pretty nice freshman season, probably an unexpected season from a productivity standpoint. You've got two talented freshmen that have already made a difference and been forced to play a lot of minutes this year in meaningful games to go with Sam Vinson and Trey Robinson. I know most people believe Marquez Work, he has a year of eligibility left. Most people believe he probably won't be back, but even without Marquez Work, you still have a pretty talented core potentially back for next year. And that's not even mentioning Keena Tijere, who is the 6'9 center that's been injured. That'll be back as well.
Yeah, and they did a nice job in the portal, in my opinion, getting a guy to come down in Keena Tijere, a guy at the big major level who's not getting minutes. There's guys out there like that, and maybe it's a guard this time around. Maybe whatever. Those guys are – it's funny. Everybody's looking at these guys moving up, but there are also guys at the high major level going, I want to play, and, oh, I can go there and play. All right, let's do that.
Well, that's a really interesting point. And talking to some coaches at that level, the mid-level, they've been talking – about that more and more, that the key is going to be able to find the Keena Tijere type guys, the guys who really didn't do anything last year. So it's going to be hard to go in and watch their film or look at their stats and say, oh yeah, that's our guy. You're really going to have to do a good job of scouting and say, hey, I think this guy was going to be something before he went to whatever school where he got parked on the bench, and look at these six clips that he showed throughout their conference season where it looks like he can still do a few things. Then you're going to have to see how that translates to your level and try to bring him in, because I think those are the real value pieces that you can add as a team in NKU situation. They got Keena Tijere that way. I think that's kind of the model now for them finding the big hits in the transfer portal.
Yeah, back when NKU was Division II, I thought Dave Beasold always did a good job of finding those Division I guys. Back then, when you had to sit out a year to transfer Division I to Division I, you didn't have to sit out if you transferred Division I to Division II or Division II to Division III. If you were going down a level, you could play right away the next year. And NKU back then did a really good job. Those guys were difference makers a lot of times, and really made some really good teams because of those guys coming down. And this feels like kind of a similar circumstance, because now Division I to Division I, you don't have to sit out, obviously.
Yeah, exactly. And I think, you know, for Dave, he had such a good relationship and was so respected by a lot of the Division I coaches that it worked out really well for him, because those guys would say, hey, I've got this guy that's not working out here, but he'd be perfect for you. They'd call him up and they'd kind of grease those wheels and set it into action. And obviously he did a great job recruiting them too, but he had so much respect from coaches around the region and area that he probably got a lot of help in recruiting that way. And I think you're right. That's kind of the same way you have to do it, just a little bit different, getting the high level guys to come down to the lower D1 ranks. Skinny, with these other teams kind of playing games the rest of the week in the midst of their conference tournament, I don't know that it does a lot of good for us to actually talk about the conference tournaments or previews or anything like that, because there's not much shelf life to it. I will ask you though, let me back up for a second. On Monday, after Selection Sunday, this coming Monday, it'll be the opening of the transfer portal that launches the day after Selection Sunday. So with that being essentially as big as the NFL free agency period that just opened now for college basketball, what would you prioritize for each program in the transfer portal when it opens up on Monday? Let's start with Kentucky.
That's a good one, because
it's a little bit different with UK, because they actually still recruit prospects.
Freshmen. Yeah, they recruit freshmen. Let's presume Reed Shepard's gone, right? Presume Rob Dillingham's gone.
Yep.
Presume DJ Wagner's gone.
We probably should, yeah.
Well, then you need a point guard. That's number one. Obviously Trey Mitchell is out of eligibility. Do you think Edwards comes back? I think he does.
He might. Let me give you my answer on this one. I think the guy you have to find a replacement for is Antonio Reeves. I think you've got, mean you find a guy who can score you 25 a game like he can, but I mean veteran presence who can shoot.
Well, that you need at least two, because you found out this year you had three with Dillingham, Reeves, and Reed Shepard. And at times, right, even Edwards has shot it pretty well. But you got three snipers. I think you need to at least have two and find two. And if you can find a third, great. But you need at least two. And I think he's learned that lesson this year.
I would agree, but I would also say the key to Reeves, the Reeves piece, is it's an experienced guy. It's a guy you can rely on that shooter. It's not a guy that's not going to hit the freshman wall in the middle of your conference season and then go 0-for-30 down the stretch or something. That's my only concern with these freshmen when you bring in freshman shooters, is they never seem to shoot quite the percentage you expect them to shoot, even if they're a great shooter, just because they're a freshman and that's what they do.
Yeah, but you asked in the portal, that's what I'm saying. Go get two snipers in the portal.
Yeah, in the portal, absolutely. You go find experienced shooters, and I think that's going to be the key for Kentucky. What about Cincinnati?
Whatever it is, it needs to be a wing scorer, and maybe even let's go two things: a wing scorer and a shooter. Would it be nice to have a skilled big? I guess, but those are hard to find. A and B, the game just doesn't play that style anymore for the most part. So yeah, I mean, they need a definitive scorer. And if Dan Skillings takes a huge leap next year, and I think he's taken a step forward this year, maybe not consistently, but he's taken a step forward.
Yeah.
If he takes another and you add another wing to that, two pretty good wings right there to build yourself around.
Yeah, that's exactly the way I'd look at it if I'm UC. I look at it as Dan Skillings may not have quite been the go-to scoring option that we wanted him to be this year. He wasn't quite consistent enough. But next year, you're hoping that he will be at least a number two type option for you at worst. So if you can add a legitimate bona fide scorer.
And Seamus wasn't even that. I mean, God love him. He was great in the West Virginia game. My Lord.
Yeah.
Dude, the second half was just off the charts, stupid good. But again, it wasn't consistent enough. And I don't
He was asked to do too much in that role.
Right. Correct. Yeah. Correct.
Yeah.
And I think you need a better version of that guy.
Yep. I would agree. You gotta find a big time shooter scorer. And I mean, really, I think everyone's going to be saying that everybody needs a big time shooter and scorer. In the offseason, when you enter the offseason, you always feel like you need that. I mean, we're going to go to Xavier. They're getting rid of Quincy Oliveri. So, of course, they need to replace that as well. But with Xavier, I would actually look more front court in terms of their most glaring need, the thing I'd prioritize the most.
Well, here's my question. What do you think Zach Fremantle does?
I think he will be back.
Okay.
Yeah,
that's a big get. I mean, that's a big get right there.
It is a big get, but it's also a guy who has undergone two stress fracture surgeries since we last saw him play.
Fair point.
It's a guy that's going to have to work himself back into shape. And then Skinny, after all that is said and done, let's say he's the exact same Zach Fremantle as we last saw playing. He was still a defensive liability.
No question.
In the front court.
No doubt.
So, like, you're still probably going to need someone that can play defense at center.
I'm with you. I just want to start at that point. And then for Jerome Hunter,
Now, he plans to come back as well, but not only is he working back from the heart attack that he had, but now he has the Achilles injury. I just don't think there's any way to rely on Jerome Hunter going into next year.
But I think they're two at least serviceable pieces at the very least that maybe not what they were, but certainly are even upgrades over these dudes this year. And then to your point, go get a couple more front court guys and give yourself a nice rotation. I mean, you didn't even have a rotation this year. I mean, you had nothing.
No, that's exactly right. And it's partly getting bodies. But I think last year that was kind of the mindset of like, okay, we've got Zach, we've got Jerome. If we add another body or two that are kind of almost starter level guys, then we'll be okay. But they weren't. And then those guys, one, they weren't even close to being starter level guys. And two, then you don't have Jerome and Zach, and now you're in a world of trouble. So this year, you've got to find an upgrade at the center position.
And then add Dalen Swain's hopeful improvement to that mix. And now you got a five-man rotation for two spots up front. That's a good place to be if that's the case.
Yeah, I think that's the big key is you have to find at least one starter for that center position, and then you can rotate guys a little bit easier.
By the way, I want to go back to the West Virginia UC game for a second. I listened to it. I have ESPN Plus, but there was too much on, so I was flipping around other stuff while I was listening to the game. Has any team ever been as dumb as West Virginia was in that second half? Have you ever seen any team be any dumber than West Virginia was in the second half of that game?
They've got an interim coach who's worried about getting his resume together right now, Skinny. I don't know if there was a lot of game planning going into that one.
My God, three technical fouls that were just stupid technical fouls on players.
They had a real chance to win that game.
Who do you think you're punking when you've got eight wins, my man? Just go make your layup and go to the other end of the floor and defend.
They beat Kansas.
Oh, no. Again, kudos to them. And Lukosius was great. He carried them. But West Virginia helped. I mean, when you're down 16, the other team helps you with three stupid technical fouls. That's just dumb.
No doubt. Honestly, that game in a lot of ways was a gift for Cincinnati. And then they parlayed it into a win over Kansas. Now, Kansas is not Kansas at all right now, but it's still back-to-back wins and a step closer to potentially one of the Big 12 tournaments. So good for Cincinnati.
Let's tell you how the gauntlet is, though. And you still have to get past Baylor, possibly past Iowa State, and then possibly past Houston. Good Lord.
Yeah, I wouldn't be getting my March Madness tickets just yet.
That is a gauntlet, dude. I would challenge any team in the country. I'd put them in UC spot in the quarterfinals of the Big 8 or Big 12 tournament and go, hey, go through this next three games and try to win it.
Right. I mean, like, if UConn was in that position right now, we'd be sitting here going, I don't know that they're going to win all three of those.
Right.
Yeah. All right, one last thing on the college basketball side, Skinny. A little bit more regional news. We don't typically talk about Louisville, but it is official. Over the last 2 years, we have made a lot of jokes, but it has come to an end. Kenny Payne has been fired as the head coach at Louisville. That happened on Wednesday. And we do have, just like we had our Bet Ohio odds for the Ohio State coaching search.
So you're going to take me by so I've not seen these yet.
We do have Bet Kentucky odds. And the good news is the answers for this one are not Calipari, Darren Horn, A.W. Hamilton. It's not all the Kentucky names. So, take a guess. Who do you think the best odds are, or lowest odds?
Because his name's been brought up. I'll go Scott Drew.
Nailed it. That's exactly right. Scott Drew at Baylor, plus 600, 6-1 odds. Do you want to take a stab at number two?
Billy Donovan.
No, he is not on the list. Oh, he is. He is dead last on the list. I'm sorry. 100-1.
I'm going to guess it's Mick.
He is fourth on the list at 10-1. And he's actually tied for third with Chris Beard.
I don't know if it was you that brought this up to me or Chad Brendel, and I knew it, but you guys brought it up to me first and whatever. His buyout at UCLA is ridiculous. And it almost seems like it's going to be impossible for this to take place if he's interested in this job. Now, maybe there are Louisville donors that desperately want Mick Cronin, willing to pony it up, but I think his buyout's like 16 mil.
Oh, wow. I didn't even realize it was that high, but it is high. I know that. Yeah, I don't know about the Mick Cronin thing. Now, I do think Louisville is a better fit for him. I think it's probably been a little bit exaggerated how much he dislikes UCLA or how much he dislikes living in California. I keep hearing people say that. I don't think that's the case. I think his life is pretty darn good out there. He may not love everything about UCLA, the job, but I think he likes living in California just fine. I don't think he's desperate to get back.
Number two on the list, Sean Miller.
Nate Oates from Alabama, 7-1.
Wow. Interesting.
Yeah. Interesting. So it goes Scott Drew, Nate Oates, Chris Beard, Mick Cronin, Jerome Tang from Kansas State, Steve Forbes from Wake Forest, Josh Schertz from Indiana State.
You know, Chris Beard's the interesting one because that whole incident with his wife kind of got, I guess, just got kind of tossed aside. Guy's a really good coach. I mean,
it's one of those situations where, you know, I mean, she obviously dismissed the whole thing, the wife of Chris Beard, or fiance of Chris Beard. So there are no charges pressed at the end of the day. And so nothing legally actually happened. He's in the clear now. We all know what happened in that situation that night. It's pretty obvious. We've got a police report. We've got what she said in the moment, and then she changed her story after the fact. And yet, you know he's a damn good basketball coach. You know he's going to win games. That's a tough situation if you're a fan base, if you're an administration. It's like, do you take the morality stance and say, this is a step too far. We don't want to employ someone who has done that and publicly been out there about them. Or do you just want to win games, which is ultimately what you're going to be judged on in your
12 and 52, man. That's I'm looking for somebody to dig me out of 12 and 52.
He can do that.
He can do that.
He can do that. There's another guy out there, Will Wade, who can do that for someone. McNeese State is running through their conference now.
They're 30. I think they're 30-3.
Yeah. I think they just won their conference tournament last night or won the semifinals.
No, they did. No, they won the conference tournament.
Yeah. So, I mean, I wouldn't be surprised to see him end up in one of these jobs either. Do you have a name that you like for Louisville at this point?
No. I mean, everyone I can go. Doesn't Scott Drew have it going on at Baylor? And, you know, is it, can he do the things he's doing at Baylor even more than he's done at Louisville? I mean, here's the thing that's happened to Louisville, and I know they can dig out from under this because they have the resources, they have the fan base. It's a crazy basketball school, so they can dig out of this. But if you're Scott Drew, do you want to dig out of that, or you want to just keep rolling with what you're doing at Baylor?
Yeah, the one thing about Scott Drew, and I keep going back to this one because he's kind of become one of those names, almost like Mark Few, where people have stopped bringing him up and stopped asking about it because, like, well, he's got such a good situation. He's had so much success at Baylor, yada, yada, yada. But at the same time, he's only making $2.7 million a year. That's not a lot by today's current standards. He doesn't have a big buyout. I mean, Baylor's a nice place to be at, but at the same time, at some point, does he look around and say, if I'm going to challenge myself, or if I'm going to get one last big payday, or if I'm going to take this a step farther in my career, I don't have a ton of time left. And I will
say this.
Got stagnant at Baylor.
He had a major rebuilding job at Baylor, right? I mean, major. It's major at Louisville, but it can certainly be done quicker at Louisville, to your point. And you're in a conference. You're in the Big 12, which is an absolute gauntlet nightmare. We just discussed how UC is going to have to go play Baylor, maybe Iowa State and Houston to win the conference tournament. The ACC anymore is meh.
It's terrible right now. I mean, the ACC, I'm looking at that. If I'm a coach getting in right now, I'd be looking at the ACC as that's a league I can pick off right away. I can get to the top of that league right away. Now, the problem with the ACC for most schools is you get worried about realignment.
Right.
But you're not the Big Ten. You're not the SEC. You're not the Big 12. Where do we fit in all this realignment talk? The ACC seems to be susceptible to falling apart, but Louisville is never going to have to worry about that. Louisville will always be a power institution in one of the big conferences, regardless, because they have the resources for it. So, yeah, if I'm Scott Drew or any coach right now, I'm looking at that Louisville job as a pretty damn good opportunity. You have unlimited resources. They can pay you as much as you could ever make at any job. You've got an NBA arena. You can recruit the number one player in the country to come there. You can win a national championship there. And the expectations for the job are lower than they've ever been after what's happened over the last few years.
I got another one for you here, and it was a rumor from this week. The Porter Moser to DePaul thing, was that a real? Was that real?
Well, so there were rumors that came out about it. It got pretty far. So what happens now is these insiders will report things that are anonymously sourced.
Was this Trilly Donovan?
Trilly did put it out there originally, and then some of these older reporters now will take this information, like Dick Weiss, who I'm sure you've heard of, was
oops.
Legendary back in the day, still around. He tweets it as if it's like a real thing now. And then it just continues to build after that. It's like, I don't think that was a real thing. Porter Moser then later tweeted that night that said, hey, I've heard the rumors. I'm not going anywhere. I'm staying at Oklahoma. But there are still strong rumors behind the scenes that Porter Moser has completely pissed off the AD at Oklahoma, that relationship has been fractured, and that he is actually looking to leave. So who knows what's going to happen with Porter Moser in Oklahoma. Oof. He'd be a great get for DePaul.
Oh, no question. It just didn't seem very logical.
A lot of people thought he was trying to use the DePaul job as a leverage piece against Oklahoma, and Oklahoma didn't budge. They were like, yeah, go ahead, have fun at DePaul, buddy.
Exactly.
Yeah, and so that might have led to Porter's tweet the other day saying that he's not interested, but we'll see how that goes. Any other thoughts on the Louisville thing before we wrap it up here, Skinny?
No, I mean, if you're the next guy coming in, you're coming in at a great time. I mean, you really are. I mean, you can only move the needle upward, and it was here's the thing, and I'm always in that camp, Rick, of bringing back alum who's got coaching chops, and it's going to work out because that's what it does. And it just doesn't seem to do it very often. It seems the right thing to do. I mean, I know Kenny didn't have head coaching experience, but he had coaching experience on a major staff at Kentucky. He had coaching experience in the NBA. He had coaching experience developing players. Everybody seemed to love Kenny Payne. It just, even though he didn't have head coach, it just felt so right. Louisville guy coming back home to get the, and it was the complete 1,000% the opposite direction.
What I would tell every athletic director is to throw out any of that cute prior relationship, it's a good story stuff when making these decisions. He's an alum. I don't care. He played here. I don't care. He was an assistant coach here. I do not care. No connections matter. None of that stuff matters. It doesn't mean it's going to help you. Go out, find the absolute best coach. Because here's the reason why, Skinny. That cute stuff, the relationship he had, the prior connections, the people, the boosters who like him, that only helps you on day one when you hire him.
Yes, correct.
On day two, it's completely meaningless. It's out the window and everybody's mad at you again. So it's like, hey, you better just hire the best guy for the job.
Right. We won the press conference. Yeah, and then you won 12 games out of your next 64. That was great.
Yeah, I would not worry about that stuff at all if I was an AD. All right, let's get into some Ask Skinny Anything.
All righty.
What is your favorite conference tournament to watch, Skinny? This is a great week for that.
I'll go the Big 12. The Big used to be the Big 8. I always thought that was a competitive one. The ACC always had the chops because they were the one that felt like got the most TV time. That's kind of changed because now they're all spread out all over the place. But I do like them. I love the Big 8 back in the day. The Phillips 66 Big 8 tournament was one of my favorites. I love the SEC one. I used to love covering it when I covered UK. I'm the guy that would go literally sit for the two quarterfinal games or that I'm not even covering just to be there because I just enjoy tournament basketball. So that was always near and dear to my heart is the SEC. But I like the Big 12.
Yeah, I like all the mid-major ones that started last week. Any of you conferences?
I like the championships of those. The lead-ups I don't watch so much, but I will watch all those championship games because, dude, like, and I fell asleep on it last night, Montana State, and I watched Montana State the night before, and I'm like, man, they've got a shot to win here. And they were 16-17 going in, and they did win, and I really wanted to see how that turned out. I mean, it was Montana versus Montana State for one of the two going to the NCAA tournament. Don't tell me that doesn't matter significantly to those people.
How about the big man from Montana State, the 6'11 walk-on from Arizona State, and he's just absolutely killing it out there. He was fantastic to watch last night. I like all the mid-major conferences, and I do like the lead-up because that week before, you know, this week we have basketball all day, every day. We can watch it nonstop. But last week, those first few games that start to trickle in where you get like the 2 p.m. game on ESPN Plus you can flip on while you're working, that's just wonderful to me. I love the conference.
Well, I loved it yesterday, and I'll probably, recording the podcast as it's on and the clicker's across the room. But right now, one of the A-10 quarterfinals is on USA Network. So,
and Xavier starts in 14 minutes here.
Xavier starts in 14 minutes as we're recording this. And actually, it's on ESPN Plus. Again, I don't usually go there when I can flip to other channels. But the MAC actually started at 11 a.m. today, so it's great.
Perfect. All right, Skinny, is Russell Wilson definitely going to beat out Kenny Pickett for the Steelers quarterback job, and does he make the Steelers better?
I don't think he does make the Steelers better. I think he will beat him out almost by default, to be honest with you. But, you know, I think Kenny Pickett, though, is taking this as a slap in the face, and maybe he responds to that. This feels very Deshaun Watson-y to me, that the Browns made such a big mistake. Now they're stuck with the mistake. And when Deshaun Watson was good, he was really good. But there's so much rust. There's so much baggage. He didn't play very well. In fact, they were probably a better team when he got hurt last year. And I think that's the same. Listen, Russell Wilson burned a Pete Carroll bridge and a Sean Payton bridge. And listen, they're both goofballs in their own way, but they both have earned their skins on the wall for reasons. They're both really good football coaches. And listen, nobody said a bad word about Russ in Seattle till he was gone. Nobody said a bad word about Russ in Denver until he was gone. And to me, that seems like that's a guy that dudes in the locker room just despise. He's always come off as phony, and I just can't. Now, Mike Tomlin's a different breed, a different cat, and I could argue that maybe he's got the chops to put him in his place if that's the case. But again, I just don't know if there's talent left in Russell Wilson.
That's the biggest question, is he any good anymore, period? And then the whole, like, Mike Tomlin dealing with him, I think is going to be fascinating, because I don't see Mike Tomlin suffering any of the pretty boy D-Vask stuff that we've heard about from Russell Wilson.
I don't think the leash would be long to put. If he has, like, two, let's just say he does become the starter and throws in two clunkers right out of the gate, as you saw last year, old boy turned to Mason Rudolph in the pinch just because he needs something different, and it worked. And I think, you know, Mike Tomlin's a great coach. I mean, the history there, I know people roll their eyes at this winning record thing. I still think there's significance to that, but they've also gone 7 years without winning a playoff game. And now the bar for them has to be win a playoff game. And you can't ride with Russell Wilson if he's struggling just because he's Russell Wilson. To hell with that. You ain't paying him enough now to do that.
Think about that. You're in a, we have to win a playoff game situation, and your big move was, we got Russell Wilson.
Well, he did get Patrick Queen too. As my boss said to me, and he's a big Steelers fan because he grew up there. He said, "Such a Steelers thing to do. They need help on the offensive line, and what do they do? Go sign a linebacker."
Thank you. That was exactly the point. That was a Mick Cronin move if I've ever seen it. You lose 50-48, and you go complain about your lack of defense. It's like they needed a quarterback. They need the offense to get fixed. Their defense is fine. Patrick Queen's great, but their defense is fine. It always has been fine. They need a quarterback, and the guy that they turn to is Mr. Unlimited, Russell Wilson.
Like I said, if I'm a Bengals fan, that move doesn't move the needle for me other than I think it makes the Steelers potentially worse.
Yeah, it feels great. Feels great if you're a Bengals fan, in my opinion.
Okay, so let's do this. Honestly, rate the four quarterbacks in the division now. It's Lamar and Burrow way up here. And it's these other two knuckleheads, Deshaun and Russell Wilson. There's a huge gap.
A huge gap now. Huge gap. And I mean, I don't know how you want to decide the Lamar Jackson, Joe Burrow thing. I don't think it matters. They're both really good.
I'm gonna couple them together.
Yeah, fine. Great. And they're both right there at the top in the top five quarterbacks in the NFL. And the other guys are floundering below the midway point, I would say.
Correct.
If Skinny was putting together the Aliens team from Space Jam, what NBA players would he steal the talent from?
Oh my Lord.
It's easy now in the current NBA, I feel like. I mean, Giannis is number one automatically. If you're stealing powers, you're stealing Giannis.
Yep. Trying to think what else.
Steph.
Well, Steph for sure, but
yeah.
I'm trying to think of something. Zach LaVine for his athleticism.
Maybe. Yeah, that's like the Muggsy
thing. He's a pretty athletic dude.
Yeah, Zach LaVine would be good. I mean, I think I got to take
LeBron.
Okay, that I didn't even have him in my original thought, but he was in a movie, so I feel like LeBron does. He was in Space Jam 2, so he deserves to be in there.
Yeah, he fits. Who else did you have?
I would say, I mean, I think I'd go Durant.
Yeah, okay. The
skinny, long, 7-foot freakish shooting guy that feels like an alien already. Luka.
Luka would be the character that somehow blows up in the end. Like, he just keeps getting so big, he just explodes.
Just fat. Yeah,
he is immense.
He is fat as can be, and he's still the most skilled guard in the NBA.
It's fun. It's literally watching old man at the YMCA just punk all the little kids on a Saturday morning because he's just bigger and stronger than everybody.
I love, like, apparently he's just going out in every city they're in, eating like 3-course meals, drinking wine, and then going out and putting up triple doubles.
It's insane. Every time I see him, it feels like he gets bigger.
I love him. I'd go Joker too, I think.
Would you have a separate Kyrie Irving character that would have a flat Earth segment of that?
He'd be zooming off in a space, because it's Looney Tunes, right? He'd be zooming off in a spaceship towards Earth, and then when he got there, he'd just smack into it because it's flat, and it would just be like a cardboard Earth. Yeah,
that's great.
Yeah. Does Skinny use Reddit, and should someone make a Skinny podcast subreddit?
You're more than welcome. I do not. I know of Reddit. I don't. I think the only time I went to it was something happened in our neighborhood, and I went there to see what was going on. Most of us, we actually have a neighborhood Facebook page, which is nice. Yeah. Like, somebody on our neighborhood Facebook page put that there's coyotes roaming around, and I'm like, oh, shoot, I got a little dog I sent out in the yard. I need to go watch that dude now. So I like those things. Or, hey, there's somebody walking around the neighborhood. Don't be alarmed. He's just he's trying to get roof estimates. Okay, I like those things.
How dramatic is your neighborhood Facebook group?
Well, it can get fairly dramatic. I mean, like, the day that I didn't even hear this was last year, maybe 18 months ago, we had a street behind us. And actually, it's not very far from where I live. It's probably 5 houses down and a block back, where their car, they had an electric car that blew up in their garage and caught fire. I didn't even hear the fire engines. And so that was all I woke up and I'm like, wait a minute, what? So I drove up there. I'm like, holy cow. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. We've spent an evening or two getting updated on the Facebook community page comments, because there are some, we live in Newport. So you get a little more drama occasionally, and maybe some people aren't quite as educated commenting on there, and they'll get into it. There are some serious fights in our community page. There's also a lot of skunks in the woods by our area, so that's a big concern. People are always calling out, hey, the skunks are back, keep your dog in.
That's funny. So when I leave my house, I have a cut through right by the airport. It's called Arrow Parkway. You may be familiar with it, but people watch the podcast don't. But I swear, the last 4 or 5 times I've driven down Arrow Parkway, somebody has run over a skunk. It's because all of a sudden you're like, oh, there's the smell again. And there he is.
Running over them, we'd take. The problem is they come out of our woods up here, the hill we live on, and they just run through everyone's yards. So inevitably your dog will be out, and the dog will catch them, will run up to them and get sprayed in the face. Like everyone in my little area here, if they have a dog, it's been sprayed within the last few years.
Has your dog gotten sprayed?
Yeah, 2 or 3 years ago, yeah.
What did you use to...
There's Nature's something or other. Yeah, there's a actual brand. I mean, there's all types of wives or home remedies that you use that we tried.
Tomato juice?
Yeah, we didn't do the tomato juice one. We did like 4 others. The best thing, though, was this like Nature's Cure, I think it's called. You just buy it at the pet store. And I've passed it around to 2 other neighbors since then, because they've had the same issue. So, all right, Skinny, we'll wrap it up with this. Our favorite John Lomax memory or story. I mean, there aren't too many institutions in this city like John Lomax. Everyone, whether you worked at Channel 12 or not, loved the man, and we all have fond memories of him.
Well, I was going to bring this up at the end of the podcast, so I'm glad that question was asked, Rick. I don't think I have a favorite memory or moment. It's just that every time I was around him, it's the truth. He made you feel better. I mean, he was just a caring, smiling, happy-go-lucky, but serious about his job guy, but not like overly serious about his job. And, you know, when I would go in to do like a Bengals segment on the morning show the last couple of years, when John was still there, we'd often talk about Tennessee sports. He's a big Tennessee Volunteer fan. So, you know, we'd always talk SEC sports, and I always enjoyed that. And he could literally, and I put this on my Facebook page, he could talk to you about any subject. And I didn't put this line in, and I kind of regret it. He could talk to you about any subject without him coming off as some condescending know-it-all about that subject, yet you'd be entertained talking to him about that subject. And I put this on my page too. And I don't know why this means something to me, but when my daughter, when she was first out of college, she worked as a manager of a Target store. And she had her last name on the name tag. And he went out of his way one day to just walk up and go, "Are you Richard Skinner's daughter?" She goes, "Oh yeah." And she goes, she said something like, "Oh, I know who you are." And he goes, "Yeah." He goes, "I just want to say hi." I'm like, "You didn't have to do that. Go out of your way to say something like that." And that's him in a nutshell. And trust me, when I saw the news, when it happened, I was crestfallen, because I can remember, because it was draft week, was like his last week or leading up to us. I came in to do a morning segment on one of his last day, maybe his next to last day. And I told him the story. I said, "John, I hope you do what my dad did on his first day of retirement." I said, my dad would get up at 5:45 every morning to get himself ready for work, get us ready for school or whatever. And I said, "Dad, what are you going to do on the first day of your retirement?" He goes, "I'm going to let the alarm go off and then I'm going to smash the clock." And that's what he did. And I said, "John, you ought to try that." He goes, "That's not a bad idea. I may just do that." I said, "Enjoy sleeping in, man, and enjoy whatever you can do." And it's a shame that, I mean, I think he was very looking forward to doing a lot of things in retirement and he didn't get that opportunity. It's just damn sad. But as I wrote on my Facebook page, thinking of him put a smile on my face, because that's what he did. So I don't have a single moment. Rick, you actually work with him closer than I did, because you were in the newsroom more often than I was, believe it or not. For those that don't know, I work pretty much remotely because I cover the Bengals and do other things. I don't go into the office very much. You did, so you probably have more stories than I have of him.
Yeah, and I mean, there are so many people at Channel 12 who are so close to the guy, and I don't want to act like I was the closest to him or anything like that, because I certainly wasn't.
But he made you feel it, I'll bet. But I'll bet you he made you feel like it.
But here's the thing about him, Skinny. Everyone who heard that news felt really personal to them, and it felt like, you know, they had a part of them kind of ripped from them, because he was that type of person, because of what you just said. You go in, you have a conversation about anything that was interesting to you, anything. And he would be able to talk about it intelligently. And, you know, I used to think it was like, originally I started working there, I was thinking, oh, he likes me being here because I'm the college basketball guy. No one else here knows college sports, so he likes talking with me about that. No. He did that with everyone had their thing with him. They'd go into his office and he'd talk to them about the grandkids for someone, or, you know, whatever, the ballet, or he was a big music guy, really knew his stuff about music, would talk about music with a lot of people. So everyone kind of felt like they had that really personal relationship with him and felt like he was a special connection to them. And so that was part of it. The other part that was so sad to me is what you mentioned about, he wasn't a guy who, like, once his job was gone, there wasn't a sense of purpose there and he had nothing to do in retirement. He was a guy that was constantly looking forward to retirement, talking about the bourbon, the photography, the music, the sports watching, all the different things that he was excited to do.
You don't get to do a lot. I mean, honestly, I did morning radio for 15 years and there's a chunk of your life that's cut out just because of the time of it. It's an odd time to go to work.
And you could set your clock by John Lomax walking in the newsroom at 3 a.m. every single morning. Because I'd come in around midnight, right, and I'd stay through the morning shows. Yep. He'd come in at 3 a.m. He was the first person there that was on the morning shows, the talent. He'd be at 3 a.m. every single morning. And we'd all, if you were like a producer, I worked on the website, but all the producers who were writing the show for the 4:30, the second they heard that back door open and John walking in, they'd go, "Oh no, it's 3 a.m. already?" Like, they'd freak out because they knew, like, oh, I only got an hour and a half left.
Yeah.
He was literally like the warning of, like, hey, you got 90 minutes to finish this thing up, because he was so consistent. I will tell you, in terms of specific memories or anything like that, it will be just talking Tennessee basketball with him in the mornings. And so next week I will be betting hard on the Vols, because if he has any favor or pool upstairs, I know exactly what he's using that for. His first favor that he's calling in is going to be a Vols Final Four trip. So I'm putting a nice little wager on them next week.
Very good call. I'm glad somebody asked that question, because I did want to end the podcast with us talking about John Lomax. So thank you for whoever asked that question.
I mean, truly a treasure.
Yep, no doubt about it. All right, Rick, we will be back next week when we preview the NCAA tournament and discuss probably where the Bengals have wrapped things up in free agency and maybe even some Reds baseball as we creep ever so close to opening day. For Rick Roaring, I'm Richard Skinner. It's been the Skinny Podcast, the weekly Potpourri edition, presented by Blake, the Attorney Mason.
You can always get local stories right here on YouTube, but go ahead and hit that subscribe button to get notifications to stay in the know.